nice, huh? And I'm sure it looked a heck of a lot better, about 750 years ago when the people were living here, when it was all together. Still looks pretty good, though. I especially like the towers. Got that square one over there. Then the round tower. The round tower actually tapers as it goes up. Man, they did some really good masonry on that. You got to remember, they didn't have any metal tools. That's just stone chipping on stone to put that thing together. And then over here, I don't know, that's like a complex of towers and shapes, square and rectangular, and actually the wall facing us, that's a curved wall. They did good work on that. And look, it's sitting on that big rock with these big cracks in it. Looks like it's ready to fall any minute now. When we go walking past there, let's just keep moving. Don't stop there, all right?
Are y'all doing anything to preserve that? That looks like...
We are. I'm going to talk about that in a minute, yeah. And then look out in the middle there. Now try to imagine how it was 750 years ago when it was all together. Out there in the middle, well, you see those things that look like windows? Those are actually doors. They made really small doors. They really didn't do windows at all. And also, there would have been a lot of flat-topped roofs. Always flat-topped. They didn't do any kind of pitched roof at all. And typically what you would have seen is a lot of ladders out there. From the flat-top roof below, there'd be a ladder leaned up to the door just above it. So you'd see a whole series of ladders going up all the way to the top. Now see up in the top there, there's kind of a ledge. You couldn't see that from the overlook above. There's actually 9 rooms up in there. It's only about 4.5 feet high. And if you look closely at that door there on the left, there's a couple of grooves in the sandstone where a ladder was more or less permanently leaned up against that from a flat-top roof just below it. And then out here in the front, you see where all these people are. You've got those big round holes in the ground. Those are actually round underground rooms. And at one time, they had a perfectly flat, smooth roof on top. It probably would have gave the appearance of a bunch of round concrete patios, you know, going down the front there. And then, of course, there would have been a lot of people living here. We're thinking about 100, 120 people living in this place. And they always get applause when I mention them. And then they were living here with their turkeys and their dogs. Now, those are the only two domesticated animals, turkeys and dogs. The turkeys look pretty much like the turkeys we have today, the wild ones, you know, big brown bird. And what's kind of interesting is they rarely ate the turkeys. They were eating the eggs. And they made good use of the feathers. They were weaving the feathers into everything, the little down feathers, even the big feathers. They had a way of splitting them down the middle and weaving them into their cloth. And then the dogs were very important for these folks, particularly for hunting. These people, they did hunting, and they did gathering of plants. You know, they knew 300 different plants that they could use for food and for medicine. You know, there's oak right there, you know, acorns, there's pinyon pine, serviceberry, and 297 others. And then in addition to that, they were doing farming. They did the farming up on these flat mesa tops up here. But back to hunting, I should talk about that. The hunting, they hunted everything from elk and deer and sheep down to rabbits and squirrels. And the way they hunted rabbits, I think, is really interesting. They would weave a big, long net out of yucca fiber, which is actually very strong stuff, and they would chase the rabbits into the net. And I can't help but think the dogs must have loved doing that. Mm-hmm. And then once you got, let's say you got a dozen rabbits, you might want to process the meat so you can eat it later on. I'm not sure how they did it. Maybe they dried it in the sun, maybe they smoked the meat. But whatever thing they did, the odors it generated must have, you know, attracted scavengers and carnivores, you know, like coyotes and foxes and everything else. But if you got a dozen dogs here barking all the time, you got nothing to worry about. So those dogs provided a really great service. In fact, we sometimes find a dog grave right next to a human grave. So these were really valued animals. And I should talk about the dog's owners, right? The people who lived here. They're called the ancestral Puebloan people. But you guys probably heard another name for them, right?
Anasazi.
Anasazi, right, Anasazi. So Anasazi, ancestral Puebloan, same thing. But I'm always going to say ancestral Puebloan because that's what the modern Pueblos prefer. The modern Pueblos, that'd be, you know, the descendants of these people who built this place. There are 21 different groups of Pueblos today. It's not one united tribe. You guys might have heard of some of them. The Zuni, they're about 150 miles south of here. And then the Hopi, they're about 150 miles to the southwest. And then over the other direction, about 150, 200 miles, is the Rio Grande River Valley. Now, for you folks who are not from around these parts, the Rio Grande cuts right down the middle of New Mexico, north to south. And in the northern part, between Taos and Albuquerque, there's 18 different groups of pueblos. A lot of them have Spanish-sounding names, like Pueblo Santa Ana, Pueblo Santo Domingo, Pueblo Sandia. And then a few have Indian-sounding names, like Taos, Zia, Acama. And then we got one more way down there in El Paso, Texas. They don't really belong there, though. Back in 1680, when the Spanish were ruling this part of the world, they forced them down to El Paso. They're like forced refugees, but they really belong up in New Mexico. So anyway, those are the 21 different groups of pueblos. They speak 6 different languages, but this word, Anasazi, is not one of their language words. It's actually a Navajo word. And Navajos are not pueblos, and it roughly translates to mean ancient enemies. And, you know, if you were a modern Pueblo, why would you want to call your ancestors enemies? So I'm going to always go ahead and use the term ancestral Puebloan, but it means the same thing as Anasazi. So I just want to make that clear right from the beginning. And the term Pueblo, let me give you a quick history lesson, right? 1492, everybody knows, Columbus comes here and he claims it for Spain. 1520, that's when the conquistador, Cortez, he goes up into Mexico City and he gets all the gold from the Aztecs. 1540, the conquistadors come up here looking for more gold. They didn't find any. They did find the Grand Canyon, and they ended up introducing horses into the Southwest. But what they did find is a lot of these Indians, they were living in towns. Towns with buildings made out of stone, just like this, but not inside these this is an alcove. I'm talking about towns up on the mesa tops, in the valleys, on mountainsides. And they built multi-room dwellings, kind of rectangular, L-shaped, kind of like a motel or an apartment building, 1-2 stories high. And they clustered all their buildings together, and around them they planted a lot of corn and beans, squash, other plants. So when the Spanish found these people, they gave them the name the Pueblo Indians. Pueblo is a Spanish word that means town or village. So basically they were calling them Indians that live in towns. And so, anyway, that's how the Pueblos got their name. Now that's the historic Pueblo, but I should be talking about the prehistoric Pueblo, the Pueblo who lived here back in the ancient Southwest, let's say around the year 1100, 1200, around then. Back then, they had a huge territory, really big, basically running from about the middle of Utah right down into northern Mexico, out west about Las Vegas, and to the east, eastern New Mexico. So that would be the big territory of the Pueblos in the ancient Southwest. And up here in the north, they call them the ancestral Puebloan or Anasazi. And then anthropologists have given different groups of Pueblos different names. You might have heard of some of them. The Hohokam, they're south of here into the west in Arizona. And then the Mogollon are kind of south and east of here, going all the way down into Mexico, the Mogollon Pueblo. They're mostly in New Mexico. And then around Flagstaff area, there's a group called the Sinagua. But they're all Pueblos, and that they lived in towns and they grew corn. And it looks like they traded with each other, which I think is really interesting. This is, 1,000 years ago. These people were trading with each other. And we know that because we find trade goods right here. We found cotton right here. And you cannot grow cotton in Colorado. That was grown by the Hohokam Pueblo down in Arizona and traded up here. We found turquoise here. And the turquoise was mined by the Mogollon Pueblo over there in New Mexico. We found blocks of salt that came from Utah. Seashell jewelry, that was a real popular trade item. And we can figure out which ocean they were coming from. They were coming from the coast of California, the coast of Texas, and from Baja California. Down in the valley, you guys came through the valley, the Montezuma Valley, Cortez, Bancas down there. They found a lot of these little copper bells that were made down in Mexico, southern Mexico. Believe it or not, they had a big trade in macaw feathers. You know that big colorful parrot, the scarlet macaw? They were actually raising parrots around here. 1,000 years ago, they were raising scarlet macaws here for the feather trade. It was a big trade in feathers. And just 4 years ago, a little south of here, about 90 miles, a place called Chaco Canyon, they found chocolate. chocolate that comes from Central America.
Wow.
So these people had this big network of trade going on amongst themselves and with the outside world. A real interesting, real sophisticated group of people, these Pueblos. But you know, the secret of their success was just corn, also known as maize. Corn. What's so special about corn is that you can grow it, and then you can dry it out, and then you can store it away. You can store away properly dried corn easily for 10 or 20 years. And that's really important around here, you know, because we have a lot of droughts. And so that's the strategy. You save up the corn during the good years, and if a drought hits, you should be able to get by. And so they were growing the corn up on these mesa tops. You know, a lot of people are surprised to learn there are no streams, no creeks anywhere in these canyons at all. None. And so they were entirely dependent on rainfall. And so they were dry farmers. They'd clear the tops of these mesas, and they'd plant corn. What happened over here? A rock? Hey! Don't throw rocks down here. This is a ranger. I'll call in on the radio if another rock comes. Let me know, please. Okay? You are okay? Really?
They should put a sign there saying people pull up.
They really should.
Scott.
Okay. Well, okay, let's try to carry on. I forgot where I was. Does anybody know where I was?
Talking about corn, dry land farming.
Oh, yeah. Talking about corn farming. Yeah, a lot of people are surprised to learn that they would grow corn up here, but it actually grows very well. Up here, we get 18 inches of rain, and you know, most of the rain happens this time of year, July and August. They call it the monsoon season. And that's right when the corn crops really needed it. And we get plenty of sunshine. You know, where, you know, Mesa Verde is not really a mesa. You know, Mesa, of course, is a flat top mountain. Mm-hmm. What we got here is like a big slant. It's a slant of about 6 to 7 degrees right into the southeast, right into the rising sun. So growing corn here is kind of equivalent to growing corn at a more southerly latitude. So we get a little extra sunshine, a little extra rain, and they did pretty well. They're growing corn and bean and squash and sunflower and amaranth. It's a type of grain. And it looks like they were also growing wild potato as well, which is a South American plant, I might add.
Mm-hmm.
So they did pretty well here. We think the population around here was about 14,000 here in Mesa Verde and the nearby Ute Reservation. And they lived on this land for about 750 years. But for 600 of those years, they built their towns, their pueblos, up on the mesa tops, right next to their cornfields. And it wasn't until around the year 1200 that we see this big move into the alcove. This is an alcove. And there's about a 75-year construction frenzy where they were building in every alcove they could find. And they lived in these places for about 100 years, and then they left, and they never came back. So those are really the two great mysteries. Why did they build these cliff dwellings, and then why did they leave after only 100 years? And archaeologists, scientists have been trying to figure out these two mysteries for over 100 years now, and literally, you know, digging up evidence and clues, and using new scientific methods to try to figure out what happened here. And they've come up with some really interesting theories. And I want to tell you about the theories, but I want to also show you the evidence and describe the scientific techniques they use. So that's my plan. That's what I want to do on this tour. But you know, the real miracle of Mesa Verde is that we have it at all. These cliff dwellings were basically left untouched, undisturbed, for about 600 years. When these people left here, when the Pueblos left, the Utes and the Navajos moved in. Not into the cliff dwellings, but into this territory. And the Utes and the Navajos have a great respect for these cliff dwellings. Actually, they have a great respect for the dead, for graves and graveyards and cemeteries and things. And somehow they knew that there were graves in and around these cliff dwellings. And so they stayed out. They stayed away. It would be taboo to enter these sites. And that's how they were protected for about 600 years, which I think is remarkable. In other places in the world, you have a group vacate an area, another group comes in and builds right on top of that. But that did not happen here. We still got these things. And so that's really pretty miraculous. So these things were left alone for about 600 years. It probably wasn't until after 1868, when the Navajos were put on a reservation, that prospectors looking for gold and silver and other minerals came up and down these canyons, and they found these cliff dwellings. And they didn't hesitate to go right inside, no problem for them. And they went right in there. And they went in there with their pickaxes and their shovel and their dynamite, and they did a lot of damage. They dug up big holes. They blew holes in the wall with the dynamite. Now, what it is they were trying to do is they were searching for treasure. Now, back in those days, people used to believe that this was somehow an outpost of the Aztec Empire, and they were thinking Montezuma's gold must be buried around here somewhere. So they did a lot of damage. And then in the decades that followed, there was a lot more damage done. People would come up here, but searching for pots and baskets and all different sorts of things. And they pulled everything they could find out of these places. And it wasn't until 1906 that these places became protected. We became a national park in 1906. We were the 10th national park, but we were the first national park dedicated to the preservation of the works of man, as opposed to the works of nature, like most national parks. So we're really a very special sort of national park. It was in 1909 that these places, this place right here, got stabilized. Now, by stabilized, I mean they basically threw out all these rocks that had fallen down from above. I think most of you probably saw that placard up above that has that photo. That photo was taken in 1891, and the whole place is buried in rubble. And so in 1909, a guy named J.W. Fuchs from the Smithsonian, him and his crew came down here and they cleaned out all the rocks. Now, they did a bit of reconstruction on that square tower over there. See the corner of that tower, the corner that's facing us? The corner fell away, but the walls are still standing. And so they put the corner back on to save the tower. That's really the only major bit of work they did around here. And that was in 1909. And then in 1934, they poured a lot of concrete. Actually, remember I mentioned that the thing with the big cracks in there, that rock with the two big cracks under there? They came down here in 1934, the Park Service did, and they came down here with concrete and steel. The plan was to shore that up, to keep that from falling down. And they knocked down that wall under there to get under there, and they were surprised to see a couple of columns of sandstone blocks stacked up underneath that rock. Apparently, 750 years ago, the ancestral Puebloan were worried about that rock falling away, too. Now, the Park Service... What's the matter?
Squirrel,
all right. So the Park Service decided to go ahead and put their steel and their concrete in there anyway. And now they're thinking that was a big mistake, you know, because it added tons and tons of weight to this place. And, you know, it's just built on fill. So... once in a while, Park Service screws up, makes mistakes. They hired me. what else can I tell? Well, you guys got any questions? Yes?
How did they get around? Did they have horses then already, or was everything done on foot?
Everything was done on foot.
Holy
no horses until...
How did they get under here?
How did they get here? That's a good question. Yeah, how did they get here? Now, they built a lot of trails down these canyons and a lot of trails across the mesa tops. But getting from the canyon up to the mesa top, that's the tricky part. What they did is they made hand and toe-hold trails. They'd pick a slope of sandstone, maybe at an angle like that, and they would cut holes right into the sandstone, about the size of your fist, and they would climb right up and down. That'd be their daily commute up to their cornfields every day. So they were probably some very strong, agile people. Can you imagine climbing down with a big load of firewood on your back, maybe during a rainstorm?
Isn't it a waste to some decent dirt around here to grow stuff?
I'm sorry?
Isn't it a long ways to where their fields were, where their dirt?
Right up there.
Yeah. It's good soil right up above the
good side? Soil right up there. Yeah. Yeah, it's a wind-blown soil. It kind of blows in from the west. It actually contains a fair amount of clay in it. When it gets wet, it kind of holds that moisture. Yeah, so that would be the way they go. Oh, they go up there. Mm-hmm. And we know they fell once in a while. You know, we got some 800-year-old crutches. So they took a dive once in a while. Yes, sir?
When did they have the fire when we came in?
That was 2003. When you drove in the park, you drove through 1996 and 2000. 2000 was the big one, 27,000 acres. And the park is only 57,000. So 2000 was a big disaster. Hey, we got to get going. Let's go on down there into the shade, take a close look at the boat. Hey, so, you know, before they ever built this place, well, you would have had a roof over your head, and there's water in the back, and this would have been just a big slope of rocks that had fallen from above, big ones and small ones. And this, so they just used the rocks that were right here to build this place. They didn't go off somewhere to quarry the stone and bring it back. They used what they had right here. But we do think they went down these canyons about 6 miles to the Mancos River, and they brought back those hard river rocks, and they made them into hammers, and they made them into axes. With the hammers, they broke the stone into the shape they wanted them to be, and with the axes, they cut down these trees for the timber. And then the mortar is really nothing much more than the soil we already have here. And so that's how they built this place. Now you can see a wide variety of, I guess, masonry quality. This wall right here is really pretty sloppy. I mean, they hardly even shape the stones. This is a little bit better. Up here is some of the best stuff. You can see we got that far square tower, and then there's a closer square tower. If you look at that, I mean, it looks as though those are bricks, but those are stones. Really shaped really nicely. It's got that nice sharp edge. They had plumb bobs for making sharp edges. And in the mortar between the stones, those brick-shaped stones, they push those little tiny rocks in there. They call that chinking. That's a chinking style, very typical of Mesa Verde. So now the thing that archaeologists really love is wood. If you look closely at these pieces of wood sticking out of the wall, it looks as though some of them, it looks like somebody drilled a hole in the wood and then shoved the cork in that hole. And that's almost what's happening here. Actually, what's going on is the science of dendrochronology. It was invented about 1930. And what that means is you can use tree rings to date things. And so they have a special tool that cuts right into the log and like extracts like a core sample, which would be a cross-section of all those tree rings. They've got a chart for this area that goes back 2,000 years. They just line up that piece of wood on the chart, and they know exactly when that tree was cut down. That's how we get these real exact dates. Here for Cliff Palace, the earliest date we have is 1190, and the last date we have is 1280. But it looks like most of the construction happened in the 1260s and the 1270s. Now, another thing that you can do with tree rings is you can see what the climate was like in the past. It's called dendroclimatology. And what they realized is the climate back then was more or less like the climate is today. We do see a couple of really big droughts. In the 1100s, there was a 50-year drought between 1130 and 1180. And then in the 1200s, the late 1200s, there was a 23-year drought, 1276 to 1299. Now, the other thing, you know, that archaeologists love to do is to dig through the trash. And, you know, you can learn a lot about people by going through their trash can. These people basically threw the trash out here in the front. And the big trash heaps, they call them the middens. That's what the archaeological name is for the trash heap, the middens. And they find all sorts of interesting things down there. There's broken pottery and corn cobs and baskets and sandals and animal bones. And the animal bones are particularly interesting. Now, logically, the stuff down at the bottom of the heap, at the bottom of the middens, is much older than the stuff at the top. And what they've discovered down towards the bottom is plenty of large animal bones, a deer, an elk, sheep, that kind of stuff. High up in the middens, now that'd be the later days, for around here that would be maybe the 1260s, 70s, 80s, no more large animal bones. They're just finding these little rabbit and squirrel bones. So it looks as though the big game animals ran off, and all they had for meat was rabbits and squirrels. We think that was due to deforestation. They used a fair amount of wood construction, but they must have burned up a lot of this wood. They lived here year-round. It's pretty cold here for heating, for cooking, and for their trench kilns. They used trench kilns to make pottery. And the pottery actually was an export item. You know, I mentioned what they imported, you know, copper bells and chocolate and these other things. What they exported was this beautiful black and white masonry pottery. And we actually find pieces of Mesa Verde black and white pottery in Kansas, in Southern California, and down in Mexico. So it was a valuable stuff that they traded. But the point is they burned up a lot of these trees and the big game animals ran off. And we could see that by looking into the middens. Now another thing we find in the middens, and I know this is gonna sound kind of weird, but that's where they buried their dead. I know, I just got done saying it's a trash heap, right? I really don't think they were thinking of trash the way we do. I mean, in the English language, trash is definitely a negative kind of word. I don't know what they were thinking. Maybe recycling, maybe, you know, you come from the earth, you return to the earth, whether you're a piece of pottery or you're a human being. But the graves are there, no doubt about it. One reason I could think of, in the wintertime, if someone were to die, the ground around here is frozen solid. And that soil down there would have been soft and easy to dig into. But we do know people were buried there in the spring and the summer because we find flower pollen amongst the bones. Apparently they buried people with flowers, just like we do today. Now a typical grave was only a couple feet deep. And people were wrapped up in a blanket and pretty much always buried with some kind of piece of pottery right there with them. And sometimes a precious stone like turquoise or jet. And looking at the bones, we can figure out how big these people were. We think men average 5'5", and women average 5'1". We have a volunteer here who's 5'5".
Well, I'm 5'5".
There, 5'5". This is for the Italians. I know. I don't know what it is in centimeters. What about that tall for a man? And a woman a little shorter. So anyway, so they're about that big. And looking at the bones, we can see what their health was like. It looks like a lot of people had arthritis and had osteoporosis. We see bladder stones. We find that amongst the bones. You know what else? We find some really badly worn away teeth. Now, they were eating corn that's ground between a couple of stones. They call that a matate and a mano. And every time you do that, you end up getting a bunch of rock flour mixed in there with your corn flour. And now that grit breaks down the enamel on the teeth. They wear away quickly. You're also susceptible to getting a lot of cavities. You know, when you're eating corn, that's pretty sweet. And so we see some people down here with some pretty bad teeth, you know, looking at the bones. Well, you know, about this time, somebody always asked me, where'd they go to the bathroom? And they went, anywhere they felt like it. But we do, actually, right down here, we find what they call coprolite. A coprolite is a desiccated feces. And things get desiccated pretty easy around here with this arid climate. But it's preserved, and we can look into it. We can learn a lot. And what we discovered is that almost everybody here had pinworm and ringworm. Pinworm and ringworm came from their turkeys. The theory is that turkey droppings somehow got into the water, everybody drank the water, and everybody had these intestinal parasites. Now, these are intestinal parasites. That's not the same thing as a disease, but I kind of wonder about disease. You know, they had pretty large populations living close together, and we do see a big population boom. But between the year 750, that's when they started living in big towns made out of stone, and 1300, that's about the time they left here, the population boomed by 1,000 to 2,000%. Another way of saying that is a 10 to 20-fold increase in population. And now this is 150 rooms, which is not that big. Here, up on the mesa top here, we got a town called Battleship Rock, and it has 800 rooms. And down in the valley, down near Cortez, there's two cities down there that have over 1,500 rooms. That's a lot of people living close together. You kind of wonder about disease. But there is no physical evidence of disease. But, like I say, you just kind of wonder about it. You know, Europeans at the same time, you know, they were having epidemics sweeping through their cities. Oh, you know, the other thing I forgot to mention, in addition to the size, is the average life expectancy. For these people here, it was only 34 years. But they had a very high infant mortality rate, maybe 50%. So if you got past your childhood years, you might live to be an old timer, maybe 40, I don't know. But what's interesting is the life expectancy and the size of the people is roughly equal to Europeans during the 13th century. So I think it was probably nutrition and sanitation which kept people short and short lifespan as well. You guys have any questions? That's good, because we're running kind of late.